Lord, now We'd like to welcome you to the services of the Center Street Church of Christ. We're very glad you're here. Our ushers are coming to the front with attendance cards, and part of that card is for our visitors. If you're visiting with us today, we hope you'll fill that out so that we might have a record of your visit. Also, if you're visiting, we hope that you'll stay around after services so that we might get the opportunity to know you better. This morning, Chad Van Laningham will lead our song service. Our preacher, Jack English, will bring the lesson of the morning. Let's read a few verses from Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 19. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds.
Good morning. Please stand as we sing. This next song, Brother Bill Ledgerwood will be leading us in prayer.
Oh. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful and glad to be here this morning to offer up our worship and our praise to you and to our Lord Jesus Christ. But Father, this morning we come with sad hearts with the loss of a longtime member, a longtime elder, a good friend, and a good example in Lonnie Farr. Father, we're so thankful for Lonnie Farr and Arthur Castleman and Glenn Oxford and the many good elders that we've had in this church. And Father, we're thankful for all the good elders we have today and for the hard work that they do to make this church what it is today. Father, we just pray that you'll be with Emma May and Connie and Chris, Steve and the entire Farr family. Father, also pray that you'll be with Shelley and Dustin Dugan, that you'll be with the May family and all those that have lost loved ones. And Father, we just pray that they might seek and find comfort in you and in your word. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for prayer. We're thankful for the avenue it gives us to come before you, to thank you for the great way that you blessed us. Father, we're thankful also for the avenue it gives us to come and ask for help in our times of need. Father, this morning we want to pray for all the many that was mentioned in the bulletin that are having health problems. And Father, we just pray, if it be your will, that they might all be restored to their normal health. Father, we also want to pray for Jake Greer and his spinal surgery Monday. Father, we pray that this surgery will be successful and that his pain will be taken away and he can live a normal life in his service to you. Father, also I want to pray for Savannah Vaughn, and we just pray that she'll be feeling better soon. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the youth of this congregation, and we're thankful for the Lads to Leader, Leaderette program, and we're thankful for their willingness to learn how to lead and to serve in the church. And Father, we just pray that we'll support them financially in the ways that we can and that we'll be good Christian examples before them. Father, we know that the youth are the future of this church. And Father, help us to be an encouragement to them and help us to keep them in our prayers. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this time of the year, fall, for the cooler weather, for the beautiful trees and the turning of the leaves. Father, we're thankful for the anticipation of the holidays where we can spend time and enjoy our friends and families. But Father, we know this world is not our home and that we are just passing through. But Father, we're so thankful for the beauty in our walk through this life in Northwest Arkansas. Father, as we sing these songs of praise, and as we hear another lesson from your word by Brother Jack, Father, we pray that we'll have open hearts and minds, and that we'll take the lesson from this church building and into our lives. And Father, as we partake of the Lord's Supper and remember all that Jesus has done for us, Father, we just pray that we'll do all these things in a way that is pleasing and acceptable to you. And Father, also pray that we'll all be built up and encouraged from worshiping here together this morning. Heavenly Father, we can't begin to understand all your greatness, your power, your awesomeness. But Father, we can comprehend the great love that you have for us, sending your one and only Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins. Father, we're so thankful for Jesus. We're thankful for the perfect life he lived, the example he set before us, for his teachings on how to treat others. And Father, we're thankful for the great sacrifice that he made for us on the cross. And Father, we're thankful for his resurrection on the third day from the grave. Father, we're so thankful for all the spiritual blessings that we have as Christians in Christ, especially knowing that we're on our way to heaven to spend eternity. Father, we just pray that we'll strive to walk in the footsteps of Jesus and that give us the courage and the strength to proclaim Jesus and his gospel to the lost, both here and afar. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to ask if it's convenient that you please stand again as we sing. Sing this next song to help prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper. When Christ the
smitten for offenses which were not his own. He for our transgressions had to weep alone. No friend with words to comfort, nor hand to help was there. When the meek and lowly humbly bowed in prayer,
the scripture reading this morning, if you'd like to follow along, is going to be from John chapter 6. And it's going to be verses 41 through 58. John 6, 41 through 58. And it reads, "The Jews, therefore, were grumbling about him because he said, 'I am the bread that came down out of heaven.' And they were saying, 'Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come down out of heaven?' Jesus answered and said to them, 'Do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught of God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that any man has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread which comes down out of heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread also which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh.' The Jews therefore began to argue with one another, saying, 'How can this man give us his flesh to eat?' Jesus therefore said to them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in yourselves. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because the Father who he so because of the Father, so he who eats me, he also shall live because of me. This is the bread which came down out of heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. He who eats the bread shall live forever."
Pray together. Father, we're so grateful for Jesus and the life that he lived and the sacrifice that he gave, and we are grateful for the forgiveness of sins that we have being in Christ. And to have that, we needed grace and we needed a sacrifice, and we're so grateful for the body that was beaten, the tears, the blood, the sacrifice. And as we partake now, and as we pass the plates and we break the bread, that we remember what Jesus did, how he suffered for each of us, so that we can live in heaven with you one day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's pray. Dear God in heaven, thank you for letting us all come together today and to worship. Please let us take this fruit of the vine in a way that's pleasing to you, and help us to take what is said today and apply it to our daily lives. Please help all those who are not able to be here today, and help them to make it to the next appointed time to come together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's bow our heads and go to God in prayer. Father in heaven, at this time we have the opportunity to give back according to the way that we've been blessed. And Father, we know that everything that we have is not ours but yours, that you have given us these things, these blessings. And Father, we praise you for that, and we thank you so much for meeting our needs, Father, and for taking care of us the way that you do. And Father, now as we have this opportunity to give back, we pray that that we would do so in a cheerful way, and that the money that is collected here today would go to help this church be strong and to be a beacon in this community, and that money would go out and touch hearts and souls and would draw others closer to you. Father, we ask this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always here. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. Though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him. Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Please be seated. Good morning. God is good all the time. And we're so glad that you're here. We're always honored with guests every Lord's Day, and we want to say a special welcome to you. And if you're from within our own community, and if you're looking for a church home, we'd like very much to talk to you about the faith and fellowship that brings us together here every Lord's Day and other times during the month or year. And we have a number of activities for young and old, and we hope that you can find something that will be of benefit and be faith-building for you. We appreciate your presence today, especially, and hope that this could be a faith-building experience for you as well. For a number of years, I served as a jail chaplain for some county jails and also had visited some state prisons on occasions. And I would sometimes ask the question, just why are you here? And the answers were often the same. Well, I was framed, or I was at the wrong place at the wrong time, made a bad choice. It's simply a case of mistaken identity, or maybe the police have something against me. Oftentimes those were the answers I would hear, and more often than not. Seldom, however, did anyone claim to be guilty of something. Most would say they were innocent. Oh, I'm innocent. I'm not, it's all a mistake. The truth is, however, that none of us are innocent, are we? For we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 3, verse 23. We've all messed up. We've all blown it in some way and failed in our regards as far as keeping God's commands. The only time that we were innocent indeed was probably at birth or as a child. But we learn that it's hard to stay innocent in a world that flaunts sin in our faces, who advertises it in everywhere and invites us to participate in it through TV and movies, sports stars, Hollywood actors. We're overwhelmed by that oftentimes. The Apostle Paul once said that he was innocent, or the King James Version, I think, uses the word pure. He was innocent of the blood of all men. Acts 20, verse 20. When I read that, I said, what in the world was he talking about? What if you suffered, for example, from a terrible disease or a sickness that would maybe take your life? And I knew of the cure for that disease or illness, but yet I kept it to myself and I didn't tell you about it. Would that make me innocent? Well, I don't think you would agree to that. Of course not. The only way that I would be innocent would be by telling you what could cure your disease or relieve your suffering. And so, brethren, we have to recognize that we as Christians have a cure for people's sickness and addiction to sin. And the cure, of course, is the gospel, the good news of what God has done for us through Jesus Christ. And if we don't share that with others, then we are not innocent of the blood of all men, as Paul stated. And so this morning I want us to look closer at what Paul says in Acts 20, and if you have your Bibles, you may wish to turn there, that made him innocent, and I believe can make us innocent of the blood of all men today. First thing, of course, is proclaiming the will of God. In Acts chapter 20, here's what Paul says in verse 25 beginning. Now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. Therefore I declare to you today that I am innocent of the blood of all men. For I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. The context here of this conversation that Paul engages in is that he was speaking to the leaders, the elders, shepherds of the church at Ephesus. As it pointed out, he says, you're never going to see me again, more than likely. He recognized that this was going to be the last time that he was going to have this interaction and this communication with them. He was on his way to Jerusalem to celebrate the Jewish day of Pentecost. He knew there was going to be a lot of folks there. He himself was a Jew. It was his tradition to be there. The Holy Spirit, however, had warned him that he was probably facing prison if he goes back there and hardships. Things are going to be tough when you get back to Jerusalem. Paul believed that he would probably die and that he wanted to make sure that he had completed the task that had been given him. And so that's why he says, I don't expect to see you again. That task is the same one, friends, that you and I have today, to go into the whole world and preach the gospel to every creature, as Jesus instructed us in Mark 16, verse 16. You see, the Apostle Paul can face these men and look them right in the eye and say, I've done my best to proclaim the will of God, the whole will of God to you. And so we must ask ourselves the question, can we look into the faces of our family, our friends, our associates, and the people that we serve or associate with and say, listen, I'm innocent of your blood because I've told you the will of God. But how do you know that something's the will of God and when it's not His will? You know, some people today claim to hear voices or see visions or have dreams that tell them the will of God. Well, I have to confess to you, I personally have never heard a strange voice that I literally thought it was God speaking to me, although others claim to have that kind of experience. I have, however, been moved, I believe, to do good things and believe that it was indeed God's Spirit leading me to do good as God promised that He would, Romans 8, verse 14. I believe the will of God can be found in this book. We call it the Bible. The Holy Scriptures, inspired by God, useful, as Paul says, for teaching and rebuking and correcting and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work, as he writes Timothy in 2 Timothy 3. I know the will of God from the Bible is that God wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of His truth. 2 Timothy 2 verse 4, or 1 Timothy 2 verse 4. And if I wanted to be innocent, or as Paul says, pure from the blood of all people, then I am going to have to proclaim the whole will of God that tells the story of the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus to the world. That's the way we become innocent of that blood. You know, I said earlier that I had served as a prison chaplain, and I used to meet with about 50 men once a week. They were never going to get out of prison. This was a state penitentiary, and they were going to die there. They were lifers, as the term is used. I've shared this story before, but let me do it one more time for those who may have never heard. I remember asking them one day, you know, why they even came to this Bible class. They didn't have to be there. They could be out in the yard, or they could be back in their cell or library or somewhere where they had access to. But why would you take out of your schedule to come here and listen to me, or as we studied the Bible together? They were not going to benefit as far as getting one day off their sentence. They were going to die there, and they knew that. I remember, however, asking that question, one very big man standing up, taking his finger and pointing it right at me and saying, "Preacher, we've blown this life, and the only hope we have is the next one." Well, obviously, he said more in that sentence than I'd been saying in weeks of coming there. These men were not innocent. But I wanted to leave innocent of their blood by proclaiming to them the will of God. And that's why Paul could claim to the innocent of the blood of the men that he spoke to. Secondly, he talks about warning people night and day. We continue to read in verse 28 as he goes on to say, "Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock, of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which He bought with His own blood. I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears." Warning people of possible danger or threat is not fun, folks. Paul's warning to the Ephesian elders here that some of their own, no doubt, was going to cause a lot of trouble and they were going to hurt the church. To say that to them had to have been a very painful experience for Paul himself. That's why he says his warning came with tears. It's emotional to warn people that you love that something painful is going to happen to them. I've had to do that on occasion, and it's a very tough thing to do, as no doubt many of you know as well. Every parent understands the need to warn children about certain dangers. We warn our children, don't play in the street, or don't talk to strangers, or don't cross the street without looking both ways. Avoid such things as drugs and alcohol, and guard against immorality and violence. We do all of that for what purpose? to try to protect them, to try to save them, because we love them. And we know the consequences of such actions can be tragic and even deadly. And that's why we go to often great extremes to do that for our children, our own family. So therefore, Paul warned the Ephesian elders about false teachers that were coming in, and because the results were going to be, or could be, eternally tragic and deadly. But it's only by warning others about possible dangers and false teachers that we can become innocent of their blood. And that was the context of why Paul does what he does and says what he says. You know, it's makers of consumer products are very conscientious about warning labels, or they could, of course, themselves be held legally responsible by a bad outcome. And so they're very sensitive to make sure that there's nothing you can purchase or buy that doesn't have some kind of warning label on it. And some of those warning labels, well, let's be honest, some of them actually border on what we would call the ridiculous, as they try to keep people safe from themselves. Let me just give you a few examples. And I didn't make these up. These are real. For example, on a bag of rocks for a rock garden, here's the warning label. Eating rocks may lead to broken teeth. Really? Okay. I won't eat them then. How about this one? You could purchase a butcher knife, and on the warning label on the butcher knife said this: please keep out of children. Okay. Let's do that. That sounds good. Here's a manual for a microwave oven. Warning: do not use for drying pets. Who does that? I mean, when's the last time you dried your pet in the microwave? Well, you'll probably only do it one time. Let's put it that way. You won't have to worry about it. Oh, here's a favorite of mine. On a bag of rat poison. Do you hear me? Rat poison. The warning label. Warning: has been found to cause cancer in laboratory mice. Well, I hope so. Rat poison, right? On a package of peanuts. Warning: may contain nuts. On a bottle of sleeping pills, warning: may cause drowsiness. Isn't that why I bought the pills in the first place? On a box of bottle rockets, listen to this, come 4th of July next, do not put in mouth. Puts a bottle rocket in their mouth. On a chainsaw, the warning says, do not stop chain with hand. Okay. And here's a good one too, finally. On a coffee cup, you buy a coffee cup, there's even a caution on the coffee cup label. Caution: hot beverages are hot. I guess there's a bureaucrat in Washington's consumer office somewhere that's making a living writing these things up, and bless his or her heart, they've got an income, I guess. But anyway, well, you see sometimes warnings, how they can be ridiculous. But folks, the warnings from the Bible, Bible warnings from God, are not meant to be funny, but they're there to prevent us from making some tragic mistakes that no doubt could cost our very soul salvation. Paul's warning of false teachers were meant to protect the early church from following those who would deceive them and lead them as Christians away from the truth of God. We today, as Christians have a responsibility to not only preach the true gospel of Christ, but to warn others of the dangers of false teachers or of a false gospel. Paul warned the Galatian Christians, for example. In Galatians 1 and 9, he said, "If anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let him be eternally condemned." That's serious. Some of the false gospels that we are hearing today in our world and in our culture especially is, for example, that there are many ways to God other than through Jesus Christ. That all religions lead to heaven. That truth is really only relative. There are no absolutes anymore. And yet I find that in complete contrast with what the Bible says. John, for example, said, "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. But whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains in him." John 3, verse 36. It was Jesus himself who said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one," let me emphasize that, "no one comes to the Father except through me." John 14, 6. Can it be any plainer than that? It's only through Jesus that we can come to God. He's made it very clear. But like the Apostle Paul, folks, the only way that we are going to be innocent of the blood of all men is if we warn others day and night. The truck I drive or the car my wife drives, they all have a number of red warning lights built into the dashboard, you know, that some warn you of low blood or low oil pressure. Not blood pressure. No, low oil. I wish they'd warn me of low blood. No, low oil pressure, or some have warn you when the water temperature gets too high and dangerous. And one warns that you'd better check the engine soon when that engine light comes on. You know, when one of those warning lights come on, I can either stop and check the problem, or I could just ignore it. Maybe just break out the light. I don't have to pay any attention to that. So therefore, I don't see it. But those warning lights are there for a purpose. And that's just, so the car maker is going to be innocent if I choose to ignore them and have trouble of some kind as a result. The Apostle Paul said that he was innocent of the blood of all men, because he had proclaimed to them the whole will of God, and he had warned them night and day with tears. Can we say that, friends? Can you say that you are innocent of the blood of your friends or of your family? Have you proclaimed the gospel to them? Have you warned them of God's coming judgment? You see, just like the Apostle Paul, only when we have done that, only when we have shared that good news or that warning, can we say that we are innocent of their blood. That's a sobering thought, isn't it? And in some ways a frightening one, because I'm confident that probably everyone here has an associate or friend or family member that we have yet to really approach them with the story of Jesus. I know there are those people in my life and my family that I haven't yet. And until I do, I'm not going to be innocent. And so together, let us make a commitment. Let's do our best to share this good news. The cure for an addiction to sin that can destroy one's soul and life. And this morning, I hope we've brought you that word that I can at least say this morning, I'm innocent of your blood, folks. I've tried to share with you. There is good news. God loves us more than we can love ourselves. And he proved it by sending his son Jesus to die in our place. We should have died on that cross because we've all sinned and we've all messed up. And the justice of God demands that death take place. But yet Jesus said, I'll take your place. And he did. He loved us that much. And he simply says, I want you to love me back. Change your hearts by faith. Change your life by repentance. Change your relationship to God through baptism. Wash the past away. Start all over. Know the security and hope of living forever. That's the good news. That's the hope, the anticipation of something better than what we know here. Something we can look forward to. And it gives us incentive to share it with others. If we can help you to make that response, if you have yet to walk that road, then we invite you to come to the front or to see me in the back when we're dismissed, as together we stand and sing for your encouragement.
Good morning. Thanks for worshiping with us this morning at Center Street Church of Christ. I have a little bit of family news to share with you. If you would, keep Charles Moody in your prayers as he suffered a recent fall, but word is he's doing okay. Also keep Jake Greer in your prayers as he's scheduled for surgery on his spine tomorrow in Russellville. Some other people we really need to keep in our prayers is Harry May is scheduled for tests on his lungs on Tuesday, but Lenora May is actually in Washington Regional Medical Center right now with blood clots in both of her legs. She's in room 4316, so keep them in your prayers, because in addition, Harry and Lorna May lost their brother-in-law, Roger Fisher, who passed away on Monday, so they're going through quite a bit right now, so keep them in your prayers. We also want to express our sympathy to Ransom Eaton on the death of his uncle this past weekend. So keep them in your prayers, as well as Lonnie and Emma. Keep Miss Emma in your prayers, the passing of Mr. Lonnie. Got a couple others that we have here. Kylie Vaughn lost her grandfather, Don Lewis, Friday morning. So let's keep them in your prayers as well. As well as David Tabeast on the recent death of his brother, Harlan Tabeast, and that's the uncle of Jason Tabeast and Melissa Davenport, and Melissa Davenport's uncle. Yeah. So lots of things to pray for, people going through some hard times right now, so keep them in your prayers. Let me see. We have a couple notes here. It says, words cannot express our deep gratitude toward you, our church family, at the passing of Shelley's grandmother. From the flowers and food to the kind words and prayers, we appreciate them all. We love this church, and we are so blessed to be part of it. And that's from Dustin and Shelley Dugan and Donald and Kathy Ledford. Another one we have here is, thank you and praise you for all for being a godly church. Your act of love and kindness is and was so appreciated by our family. The lunch was wonderful, act of God's love, and it was so good. And that's from Vicki Murray and family and Donald Ledford and family. To put on your calendars for the youth will be doing the services tonight. So look forward to that and come back tonight and worship with us as our young men will be leading our service. And so because of that, there will not be class tonight for the 3rd through 12th graders. So that won't happen tonight. Also put on your calendars next, this coming Saturday, the hayride at the Van Landinghams. So look forward to that. And then the next weekend is the Deeper Youth Conference here at Center Street. And the cost is $10. And Darren will handle the registration, but he needs to know the sizes of the t-shirts if of the kids that are attending. And if you can help, let Darren know. And also, there's going to be needing some housing for people coming in from out of town. So if you can help with that, look in your bulletin. There's a website you can go to or a phone number that you can call. And then also on Lads to Leaders, it's kicking up. It's getting into gear. There will be a Lads to Leaders fundraiser at Jason's Deli next Sunday, and the times are between 4 o'clock and 9 o'clock, so you have to either go before evening services or after evening services. But you have to mention the Center Street Church and Lads to Leaders when you dine in or take out of that. And we do have a minimum number of people that we need to participate in that fundraiser for us to get some funds out of that. And then save the date for December 2nd for our annual Lads to Leaders lunch and silent auction. I believe that's all I have. Does anybody have any other announcements? Okay.
I have had several questions regarding our parking.
You have stickers with me today. Several of you have already got those. To answer a few of those questions, vehicles will not be towed during services.
This will be before the Sunday morning service. If you plan to have a vehicle here overnight,
then it'd be good for you to have one of those parking stickers.
If you get one, please put it on the driver's side windshield.
It goes on the inside of the windshield. For Sunday evening and Wednesday evening, because our attendance is much lower, we will not be towing. We still allow our neighbors to park here free all week. This is just Sunday mornings because we do have a large crowd. We've asked them to park, and they do have parking spaces available for them elsewhere. And so that frees up our parking for our visitors and our neighbors. I do have those stickers with me, so if you'll come down and have a closing prayer, I can get you one if you need it. If you're not going to be here overnight, really early on Sunday mornings, you probably don't need to worry about anything. All right, let's please stand as we sing the first and last verse of this closing song from Brother Eugene James.
Time is filled with temptation.
Thank you. Let's pray. Dear God, as we come before you this morning, we want to thank you for all the many blessings you've given us. We thank you for this weather that we've been giving, that we've been getting. Lord, we thank you for the leaves changing colors and this beautiful fall weather. Lord, we thank you for this church family that we have, this congregation, and this chance that we have to meet here every Sunday morning. God, we thank you for the elders and all they do for this church. And Lord, we just thank you for all that you've given us. We ask that you be with all those who are sick and all those who need you right now. Lord, please lay your healing hand on them. God, as we depart, we ask that you be with us in our day-to-day lives and until we meet here again, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.